Everyone, welcome back to Love and Faith ASMR. And today we're going to continue our reading from the Messiah Bible, or the Messiah version of the Bible. Well, it's just the New Testament, actually. And we ended last time in a few pages into Luke. Go check that video out if you haven't yet. So, we'll begin. Okay. At that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for the census, and because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child. Time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary kept all these things in her heart. Included, you know, that's not necessarily key to the story, but it's in there, so it is. It has to be important if it's there. But she kept all those things in her heart, and she thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had. 8 days later, when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given him by the angel even before he was conceived. Then it was time for the purification offering, as required by the law of Moses, after the birth of a child. So his parents took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. The law of the Lord says, "If a woman's first child is a boy, he must be dedicated to the Lord." So they offered the sacrifice required in the law of the Lord, either a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. At that time, there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was reveal to him that he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. That day, the Spirit led him to the temple. So, when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus, to the Lord as the law required, Simeon was there. He took the child in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace, as you have promised. I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people Israel." Jesus' parents were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, the baby's mother, "This child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall and many others to rise. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul." Anna, a prophet, was also there in the temple. I do remember this, but it's been a long time, and I think it's great that we have a female prophet here. That's awesome. She was the daughter of Phanuel, forgive me if I'm pronouncing that wrong, from the tribe of Asher, and she was very old. Her husband died when they had been married only 7 years. Then she lived as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but stayed there day and night, worshiping God with fasting and prayer. She came along just as Simeon was talking with Mary and Joseph, and she began praising God. She talked about the child to everyone who had been waiting expectantly for God to rescue Jerusalem. When Jesus' parents had fulfilled all the requirements of the law of the Lord, they returned home to Nazareth in Galilee. There the child grew up healthy and strong. He was filled with wisdom, and God's favor was on him. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When Jesus was 12 years old, they attended the festival as usual. After the celebration was over, they started home to Nazareth, but Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents didn't miss him at first, because they assumed he was among the other travelers. But when he didn't show up that evening, they started looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they couldn't find him, they went back to Jerusalem to search for him there. 3 days later, they finally discovered him in the temple, sitting among the religious teachers, listening to them and asking questions. All who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And this is when he's just 12 years old. His parents didn't know what to think. "Son," his mother said to him, "why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been frantic, searching for you everywhere." "But why did you need to search?" he asked. "Didn't you know that I must be in my father's house?" But they didn't understand what he meant. Then he returned to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them, and his mother stored all these things in her heart, just like it said earlier. Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and all the people. It was now the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius, the Roman emperor. Pontius Pilate was governor over Judea. Herod Antipas, was ruler over Galilee. His brother Philip was ruler over Etruria and Trachonitis. Lysanias was ruler over Abilene. Annas and Sapphias were the high priests. At this time, a message from God came to John, the son of Zechariah, who was living in the wilderness. Then John preaching that people should be baptized to show that they had repented of their sins. Isaiah had spoken of John when he said, "He is a voice shouting in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way for the Lord's coming, clear the road for him. The valleys will be filled and the mountains and hills made level. The curves will be straightened and the rough places made smooth.' And then all people will see the salvation sent from God." When the crowds came to John for baptism, he said, "You brood of snakes, who warned you to flee the coming wrath? Prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sins and turned to God. Don't just say to each other, 'We're safe, for we are descendants of Abraham.' That means nothing, for I tell you, God can create children of Abraham from these very stones." Wow. "Even now the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever the roots of these trees. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into the fire." That's so applicable, and that's, I'm sure, going to be applicable for all time. It's not enough for us to just be like, "Oh yeah, we're from Christian homes." We're just like how they're saying, "Oh yeah, we're Christian. We're descendants of Abraham." I know that means that they're Jewish, but I'm drawing a parallel to today. That doesn't mean anything. You can't just put a label on something. And here he's saying you must live. Prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sins and turned to God. Yeah. That's hard to do, but I think it's about your intention. Thank goodness we have God's grace and forgiveness when we fail with that, but we try. Crowds asked, "What should we do?" John replied, "If you have two shirts, give one to the poor. If you have food, share it with those who are hungry." Even corrupt tax collectors came to be baptized and asked, "Teacher, what should we do?" He replied, "Collect no more taxes than the government requires." Because they would often "Should we do?" asked some soldiers. John replied, "Don't extort money or make false accusations, and be content with your pay." Everyone was expecting the Messiah to come soon, and they were eager to know whether John might be the Messiah. John answered their questions by saying, "I baptize you with water, but someone is coming soon who is greater than I am. So much greater that I'm not even worthy to be his slave and untie the straps of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He is ready to separate the chaff from the wheat with his winnowing fork. Then he will clean up the threshing area, gathering the wheat to his barn, but burning the chaff with never-ending fire." John used many such warnings as he announced the good news to the people. John also publicly criticized Herod Antipas, the ruler of Galilee, for marrying Herodias, his brother's wife, and for many other wrongs he had done. So Herod put John in prison, adding this sin to his many others. One day, when the crowds were being baptized, Jesus himself was baptized. As he was praying, the heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit, in bodily form, descended on him like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, "You are my dearly loved Son, and you bring me great joy." Jesus was about 30 years old when he began his public ministry. Okay, we've got a lot of names coming up, so that means I have a lot of names I'm going to accidentally butcher. I apologize. I'm going to do my best. Yeah. Okay, let's do this. Jesus was known as the son of Joseph. Joseph was the son of Heli. Heli was the son of Matthat. Matthat was the son of Levi. Levi was the son of Melchi. Melchi was the son of Janai. Janai was the son of Joseph. Joseph was the son of Mattathias. Mattathias was the son of Amos. Amos was the son of Nahum. Nahum was the son of Esli. Esli was the son of Nagai. Nagai was the son of Maoth. Maoth was the son of Mattathias. Mattathias was the son of Simeon. Or maybe it's Simeon. Simeon was the son of Joseph. Joseph was the son of Jodah. Jodah was the son of Jonan. Jonan was the son of Rissa. Rissa was the son of Zerubbabel? Maybe it's Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel was the son of Shealtiel. Shealtiel was the son of Neri. Neri was the son of Malki. Malki was the son of Adi. Adi was the son of Kosam. Kosam was the son of Elmadam. Elmadam was the son, maybe it's Elmadam, was the son of Er. Er was the son of Joshua. Joshua was the son of Eliezer. Eliezer was the son of Jorim. Jorim was the son of Matthat. Matthat was the son of Levi. Levi was the son of Simeon. Simeon was the son of Judah. Judah was the son of Joseph. Joseph was the son of Jonam. Jonam was the son of Eliakim. Eliakim was the son of Maliah. Maliah was the son of Menna. Menna was the son of Mattathah. Mattathah was the son of Nathan. Nathan was the son of David. David was the son of Jesse. Jesse was the son of Obed. Obed was the son of Boaz. Boaz was the son of Solomon. Solomon was the son of Nashon. Nashon was the son of Aminadab. Aminadab was the son of Admin. Admin was the son of Arni. Arni was the son of Hezron. Hezron was the son of Perez. Perez was the son of Judah. Judah was the son of Jacob. Jacob was the son of Isaac. Isaac was the son of Abraham. Abraham was the son of Terah. Terah was the son of Nahor. Nahor was the son of Serug. Serug was the son of Reu. Or maybe it's Reu. Reu was the son of Peleg. Okay, we're almost done. Peleg was the son of Eber. Eber was the son of Shelah. Shelah was the son of Canaan. Canaan was the son of Arphaxad. Arphaxad. That's cool. Arphaxad was the son of Shem. Shem was the son of Noah. Noah was the son of Lamech. Lamech was the son of Methuselah. Methuselah was the son of Enoch. Enoch was the son of Jared. Jared was the son of Mahalalel. Mahalalel was the son of Kenan, or Kenan, I don't know. Kenan was was the son of Enosh. Enosh was the son of Seth. Seth was the son of Adam. Adam was the son of God. All right. I probably pronounced, I think maybe 50% of those names correctly. Okay. I really love the way some of those were, names feel, though. Like, what was one I really liked? I mean, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it correctly, but Mahalo, it just sounds. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. That's a long time. Jesus ate nothing all that time and became very hungry. Then the devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become a loaf of bread." But Jesus told him, "No. The scriptures say people do not live. Then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of the time. In a moment of time, excuse me. "I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them," the devil said, "because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it all to you if you will worship me." Jesus replied, "The scriptures say you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem, to the highest point of the temple, and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off, for the scriptures say he will order his angels to protect and guard you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone." Look at that, he's using God's own word against God. I don't think that's smart. Jesus responded, "The scriptures also say, you must not test the Lord your God." When the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came. Interesting. Until the next opportunity came. It's important to note that when Jesus resisted temptation from Satan, did so with the word of God, with scriptures, with truth, not with his feelings. That's something